And today we're going to start by coming into just a seated position, cross-legged or full lotus or however you're comfortable sitting. And I want you to be nice and tall in your seat. If you have an extra yoga mat, you can really sit on it. And this elevates your hips and helps you tilt your pelvis. And just close your eyes, let your hands relax on your knees. And just notice your breath, just to start with. Very simple. For some of us, it's easier when you close your eyes, or you can just choose one spot to look at. So without losing the softness, isn't there more? Without losing the softness, imagine that you're breathing in this exquisite light. And when you're breathing out, you make the space around you a little brighter. We'll get it in a moment. Now, I want you to lift up your hands and just notice the space around your hands. You can sit still breathing in the light. And just feel your fingers, your palms, the area around your hands. It's okay if you put them up high, you can put them down low. And then, as if you're trying to shake water off your hands, just shake out your hands. Fling them around. If you listen, there's a very distinctive sound. And then bring your hands to stillness right above your knees again, and just pause for a moment. Feel the sensations around your fingers, in your palms. And then turn your palms to face one another, and very slowly start to bring your hands towards one another, pausing at one moment before they touch. So that moment before they touch can be a big, like a soccer ball size, or bowling ball, or maybe a little ping pong ball. But play with the energy a little bit. And we'll give you a mat in a moment, folks. Sometimes it's easier to feel with your eyes closed, and you might even notice that you can continue breathing and you don't lose connection to the energy in between your hands. And when you're ready, bring your hands to a spot on your body that you want to bring vitality to, health to, or transform or heal in some ways. Even if that spot is to heal your emotional body or your mental body, you know where to put your hand. And if you're not sure, stop thinking about it and just put your hand somewhere. And you can't be wrong. And continue to breathe. The one thing you can count on is change. But when you participate in that change, this creativity and this opportunity is one of the ways that healing will come into your body. Without your participation, it's usually unlikely. It will still continue to change. But without your intention and work and energy, it usually doesn't necessarily go in the direction that you would say is good. When you're ready, bring your hands back to your knees and continue to connect again with your breath. You can even already engage your Mula Bandha very slightly. So if you're not sure what that is, it's lifting up your perineum, the Melanbord. Like if you pull it up towards your, I know, the spotty Swedish is awesome. But you pull it up towards your spine, up towards the crown of your head, really. And you can lightly pull in your Uddiyana Bandha, which is about 2 fingers below your belly button. Again, if you don't totally understand what I'm talking about, great. There's room for improvement. But the bandhas are, you can imagine them as, often they're referred to as locks, but you want to think of them more as gates. Because you have to kind of keep closing the gate. You can't ignore it. And also, when you want to open the gate, it's there for you to open. With your next inhale, softly open your eyes. And just shake a little bit, maybe move a little bit. And if you know that you're fairly flexible, or maybe if you don't, we need an extra yoga mat for our lovely friend Boris here. And don't worry, we'll give you props and things. And we need a long one for
I'll trade you for it, sir.
Wonderful. So we are going to go with a stomach and spleen series, even though I thought I was going to teach a heart series today. But with the stomach and spleen, it has a lot to do with emotions and a lot to do with feelings. So either way, we're kind of talking about a lot of times the same things, especially if we can find this sometimes. So with the stomach and spleen, they are always coupled together like a pair. And we're going to start in, ta-da, butterfly. So bring the bottoms of your feet together. You want your heels about 2 hands length away from your groin. So if you're not sure, it's usually a little bit longer. You're basically measuring from the spot where you fold at your hips to your head. So this way, eventually, you can cradle your head with your feet. But maybe today you're just dropping your chin, but most likely somewhere in between. So pull upright and then curve and curl down. So for those of you who haven't practiced a yin practice before, You want to enter into the poses with three things in mind, or three principles, just how you come into the pose. The first is to find the right shape for your body. We're very used to seeing, you know, magazines and like posters of yoga. Lots of beautiful women, slender and very flexible often. But your body might actually not be shaped like that. And more interestingly, your bones aren't even shaped the same as the next person. So you want to find the right shape for your body. The next principle is to come into this shape and relax as much as you can without losing, you know, corporeal incarnation or the shape of the posture. So you want to let your muscles go slack. You can imagine your muscles kind of melting off their bones. And then the last principle is to be still. Well, no. The last principle is to be still, but the relaxing and totally being chill with your muscles is about making your body also still. So without the little fidgeting, without the minute adjustments all the way through the pose, you want to let the softness of your pose surrender to the change happens from your release to gravity, not your finickiness. And then the last principle is to stay. And in a yin yoga class that won't be ever longer than 10 minutes in a pose, usually it's about 5 minutes in a pose. And the reason this is, is so that there's time for your ligaments to actually participate in the pose. Our muscles are quick response flesh, and our ligaments are long response. So you can think of like an old piece of chewing gum or saltwater taffy. And that's kind of the substance of your ligaments. So if you yank and aggressively pull the two ends apart, it will snap. But if you just patiently and consistently and gently pull them apart, they'll slowly start to stretch out. And our ligaments have this in their nature. And it's really only after 3 minutes you might start to notice it in the pose, where your ligament goes, ah, okay, you really mean this. Place your feet on the ground. Bring your fingers right back behind you. You're going to lift up your hips, and you're going to stick out your tongue, and you're looking at your third eye, and with a whisper, you're going to roar like a lion. So you're going to... Beautiful. Inhale, lift your hips even higher, push the ground away, and exhale. You might have to wipe up your chin. This next posture we're coming into is deer pose. And you can see them out in the field. You see them all the time. They're sitting like this, right? You're going to bring one foot going back behind you and one foot in front of your groin. And you, the closer you bring your heels to your body, the easier the pose is. So if you're, say, Aurora and a dancer, or flexible person even with a funny attitude, to make it more intense, you take your heels further away from you. And you're going to lift up tall, and you're going to turn towards the leg that has your foot in front. And you're going to bring the opposite hand to your knee, and maybe relax the hand, the other hand behind you. And then first you're going to turn, beautiful, to that side. And then you're going to let your head drop. Now you may stay here, or you may be wanting to turn a little bit more, and you can drop down to that side, trying to keep your right hip heavy, or the other hip heavy. And don't worry if you're going in, you're great there, Chris. You can just let your head drop, coming into the back. And with some of the yin poses, the immediate effect might not be so dramatic, but it's this power of staying that actually lifts up the intensity. So take a full inhale, and with your exhale, just release into the pose a little bit more. Allowing yourself to breathe. Allowing yourself a little bit of surrender. Feel a little bit more of what's happening deeper inside. So in the pair of the stomach and the spleen, the stomach is the more yang organ, while the spleen is the more yin organ. In traditional Chinese medicine, what this means is that when we're looking at the stomach, the more yang organ, we tend to look more at the physical elements and what it does in the body. And while the spleen still does things in the body, in the traditional Chinese medicine, the emphasis isn't just on the physical task of the spleen, but also the psycho-emotional and mental elements of the spleen, including also the energetic as well as spiritual. And inhale, lift that. Take out your legs, move around a little bit. It's socially acceptable to moan and groan after a yin pose. Kind of tap the attitude like, why is this happening to me? And then we're going to come into dragon pose. And again, this is a little bit of a more yang pose. You're going to you can come up into downward facing dog. And then step your right foot all the way forward to your right thumb. And today we're going to come into baby dragon wing. So you're going to let your knee drop out, and you're going to come off the outside edge of your foot. You can stretch your back leg back. You just want to make sure your foot isn't sickling in. So straighten, pull your toes, straighten your foot out if you can, Boris, your back foot.
Yes.
And then either you're going to stay here and drop your head, or you're going to come down onto your elbows, or you're just going to lie down and take a nap.
Somewhere in between, most likely.
So hanging out here is totally, it's totally worthwhile if you're feeling it. Nice. And you'll be happy to hear we're not staying in this part of the pose for a full 5 minutes. So some of the postures, I think you want to bring your foot a little further forward if you can. Some of these postures have a very yang element in it. But as the world is, not no yin without the yang. And even when we're looking at the yin side of things, you've got that beautiful white dot in the middle of it. Our trouble generally isn't excluding the yang from the yin. It's a little bit of the other way around. And then inhale up, and you're going to toe heel your right foot to your left hand, and you're going to bring your leg down. You might find that you want to put something underneath your right buttocks, if it's way up in the sky. So instead of leaning over to your right, you want to stay with your hips centered. So if your right foot is like way in the ceiling, like find like books or sweatshirts or something to use as a block or a bolster to make it more intense to take your foot up to be parallel with the pounding mat. And Chris, you want to slide so that both your hips are pointing forward, so your right buttocks will be lifted. And we're going to stay lifted here. We traditionally often go straight into sleeping swan. We want to stay lifted here. And you might even feel the kind of squeeze into your left kidney. And our organs are very much like the rest of us. They like to be squeezed. They like to be hugged. They do better when they're squeeze and therefore full of life and vitality. Weird, huh? So one of the challenges when we're working with flexibility is to encounter the edge of your flexibility. And instead of saying, oh no, saying, oh yes. So there's an element where often when we're confronted with our own inflexibility or our weakness, our patterns come up, what we're used to doing. Whether you blame other people for it, or yourself, or which mantra you take up with self-loathing, or frustration, or not good enough, or whatever it is, that we all have our, like, tailor-made for ourselves little morsel that we like to take in there. And so on the yoga mat, you can start to notice, oh, you know, maybe I should try something else. Because you're on your mat, and you're in this much smaller moment. So it's not about your relationship, or your life, or your job. This is just your practice. So if you have these moments where you notice, oh wow, whenever I'm uncomfortable, I think the other people around me are wrong. Or even last night, whenever someone's trying to help me, I get kind of irritated and angry. And it's not a logical response. But once you start to notice it, it can be really helpful for you, and in turn for the people around you. Now, walk your hands forward and come into sleeping swan. Take a full inhale, and with your exhale, just sigh out. So I was starting to say that with the yin, the more yin organ in the organ pair is the one that is more responsible for expressing not just physically in our body, but also energetically, emotionally, and spiritually, which is a little awkward even for alternative communities, that our organs affect us spiritually. But when we actually contemplate how our life occurs to us and what's challenging for us, our body has a large role to play in our biographies, and therefore in meeting our karma, in developing and becoming who we can become, how our personality expresses itself. So particularly, the spleen is linked to thoughts, and it houses our intentions. So it's not just our analytical thinking and memory and cognition, but it's really this thing that we build up with our intentions. The spleen also has an effect on our emotions that it helps us be more trusting. It expresses honesty, acceptance, openness, balance, equanimity. And when the spleen and stomach meridians and organs are challenged, those positive elements in the psycho-emotional expression turn into worry and excessive thinking. And you can even say, myopic thinking or dogmatic thinking. So thinking that is stuck inside of itself. Because when we notice our own thinking, healthy thinking life, we start to notice that we actually think with all the people around us and all our experiences, and we think with all of so many layers of our culture and our history and our dispositions, as well, you know, as our biographies and our personalities. Like, all of these elements affect our thinking. You can take it with a very simple thing. Like, imagine if, you know, you grew up in a family where everyone was shorter than you. You're the tall one. Then you walk out into the world and you notice, actually, you're pretty short. You're just not as short as your family. So these ideas that we develop about ourselves and about the world are very much filtered through lots of things. So our thinking doesn't happen by itself. And the danger is when the thinking happens just by itself, where someone very strongly believes everything they think, or very strongly believes just one source, that imbalance can be as, you know, expressed in our thinking, just like, imagine if you could only eat carrots, or if you only ate one thing. Your vitality and vitamins and health would be diminished. Notice as you get into the depth of this posture that you hear me less and less because of your feelings. Take another full inhale. Sigh out your breath. And bring your hands underneath your shoulders. Tuck your right toes under. Lift into downward facing dog. And I know you don't want to feel like you're moving that right leg, but shake it out. Shake out your right leg. Flap it like a wing. Just move it. It will change your feelings. Take a big inhale. If you exhale, moan gloriously well. Beautiful. And now, take a moment to set your intentions. The other side is going to be so amazing. Totally cool. So stretch your left leg up to the sky and step your left foot to your left hand. And for baby dragon, doesn't it sound like a heel? You're gonna toe heel your foot just a little bit more to the outside, and you're gonna roll to the outside edge of your foot as you let your knee drop out to your left, like a little wing. And you're either gonna stay here with your hands on the ground and your head relaxing down, or maybe you find the freedom to drop your elbows down to the ground. Or maybe you lay your chest down on the ground. You want to be right at the edge between what's lovely and good and what's annoying and hard. Yeah, exactly. And you'll start to notice about yourself that you have a tendency to go a little bit more to this side or a little bit more to that side. My teacher, one of my teachers, Paul Grilly, he has a very good example of the extreme. So, you know, have you guys seen Monty Python? I think it's The Meaning of Life, where the Black Knight gets in a fight. And like his arm gets chopped off, and the other guy's like gonna walk away. And he's like, "What are you doing? You coward! Come back here and fight me." He's got like blood streaming from his arm. And then like chops off the other arm and goes on. And basically it's like this no pain, no gain. Like the guy keeps fighting until he's got no limbs. The other extreme is can be typified by like Oscar Wilde, who was quoted as saying, "When I get the urge to exercise, I lie down on the couch until that urge passes." Or maybe the other picture is the princess and the pea. You know that fairy tale where there's a pea in underneath the 12th mattress, but she can't sleep because it's so uncomfortable. We know some people like that, or maybe we're that person where you move the pillows on the couch and it's all wrong. And then lift up your head, and you're gonna walk your left foot to your right wrist and drop your shin down, your foot lifts up. Adjust for you, so bringing your shin more or less parallel to the top of the mat. You wanna look back and see that your back foot is gloriously stretching long, like your foot's an extension of your leg, and not like, you know, the duck circle. And so instead of lying down to the left side, come up to center. You can put mat folded in, or two mats underneath your left buttocks. And that's not because of your lacking. It's really about like lifting the floor up to you. And we're gonna stay lifted here, which we don't do very often. And so this side is accelerating your right. You can really feel your right. And if it's too much on your knee, I can show you an alternative pose. Check this out. So, if it's making your knee suffer, you come onto your back, and we're doing the left side. So you're gonna take your left ankle to the outside of your right knee, and then you can even thread your left arm in between your legs and either hold onto the back of your right thigh. You can relax your head onto the ground. If you have a little bit more freedom, you can also hold on to the front of your shin. Beautiful. See if you can hear other people in the room breathing. And then start to walk your hands forward, coming into sleeping swan. Here, is that enough with that little one? Or? And even as you come into it, take a big inhale, look, exhale, just sigh out. In our body, the spleen has a lot to do also with how the timing of our meals have to be. So if it weren't for our spleen, we'd have to eat at exactly the same kind of times so that our body wouldn't run out of nutrients. Responsible of raising, like it takes the pure, raising the pure is what the expression is in traditional Chinese medicine. It controls the raising of qi, the pure qi, taking that from our food, from the nutrients. So just take a couple moments and kind of, you know, just with your knowledge of the spleen, and with your knowledge of thinking, kind of think about how can our spleen and our thinking be so intimately related. Or maybe how can our eating and our thinking be so related? this earth element of this plane. Kind of points to the right nutrients being given to our body to be here on Earth. And the clear thinking to help us be here on Earth. But what's amazing is, you know, this earthbound quality of this plane, it houses thought, which you can imagine really thought is the roof of the house, and that's pointing upwards. So thought can actually, free thinking, we can actually connect to far greater realms than just what's in front of our face. And with your next inhale, lift up, bring your hands underneath your shoulders, wiggle and stretch the left leg up, moan and groan, just move, don't think about it, shake it out. Connection between our food and our thinking, our nutrients in our thinking, our organs in our thinking. You know, if we've been raised in an allopathic kind of understanding of the word, of the world, it sounds kind of crazy. You know, obviously our brain is just for thinking. But when we actually look at our own biographies, it's not so insane. You may have noticed, I don't know, in your lifetime, in your long life, you've maybe had a hangover. It seriously depletes your body of stuff, especially if you've like, or like if high fever, where you've thrown up a lot. In those places, our thinking is compromised. It's not coincidence. Or maybe you've been really nervous about something. You feel it in your stomach. And like you can't figure out simple things. can really tell us a lot about ourselves. But the biggest challenge is we take our thinking so personally. One of the places you can sometimes experience the ability to witness yourself in thinking is in a meditative practice. I remember the first moment I had this experience of, I was in my head and I was reciting a verse while thinking about something else. And this division is actually something we do a lot more than we notice. Part of why you want to work on concentration, to really focus your whole self on something. In meditation, you can also witness yourself meditating, or witness your thinking, which was that, the two thinking is a little bit of an experience of that. So this witnessing points to something that we can use, that is for our biographies of use. We notice ourselves and we can make different choices. Roll onto your belly. Emotional. So one of the ways to develop more freedom in your life is just to notice how you are, who you are, and how your choices matter. And it's not just your choice in like brands, or not even just your choice in food, it's your choice in what to think. And roll back onto your belly. Moan and groan a little bit. And then flip over, roll over and flip over. So I want your feet to come towards me and for you to be in your back. And we're just gonna do like a young two breath twist. So hug your knees up to your chest. Another little work on freedom is to lift up your face and kiss your knees. Thank you. Loving your body and yourself liberates you from a lot of capitalism. And then open up your arms and then just drop your knees to your left.
Left. It's all right, we're gonna go back to the other side. Take your gaze away from your knees. Take a full inhale with your exhale, just sigh out. And then come back to center and take your knees to the other side. Drop your knees down. Take a full inhale. And with your exhale, just sigh. And then come back to center. And stretch out, coming into Shavasana. You want your palms open to receive, and you can kind of feel like you're like about to do a snow angel or a sand angel. Close your eyes. Let the ground and the earth carry you. She can carry us all.
invite your breath to the edges of your body. Wiggle your fingers and your toes and your face and your nose. And then roll over onto your left hand side, stimulating your Surya channel, your Pingala channel, the sun channel of your body, after our moon practice. And just feel into your vitality and vibration and think like a beautiful yes for your day. And then help yourself up into a comfortable seated position. Allow your hands to meet at heart center. Feel the earth below you and notice when you push down and root down towards it, you have more freedom to lift up above it. Empty your breath and let's close with one final om. Take a deep inhale. Transforms and turns into what is my livelihood. So it's pretty